Story Church, we're going to get started in about 2 minutes. 2 minutes. Go ahead and make your way to the sanctuary. We're going to get started in 2 minutes.
Said. Every major scholar in the world agrees a man from Nazareth walked this earth until they nailed him to a tree. Although I say they, I really mean we. We mocked and tortured him. He was nothing more than an animal we sought to put down. Some were calling him a king, so we buried thorns into his skull. Our disgust was his crown. Jesus, blasphemer. How could he claim to forgive the destruction men caused? That he could reconcile us with the only true God? That's why we strung him up and didn't care to watch him die, since he was already dead to us. We were all enemies, rebels from the start. Even after deliverance from Egypt, Pharaoh never left our hearts.
All righty. Go ahead and stand up. We're going to get started with some praise and worship this morning. He is risen. There we go. Thank you. We got one person. Let's try this again. He is risen. All right. Come on. Lord, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for this opportunity to worship you. And Lord, as we come together and we raise our voices and we remember what you've done for us this morning.
For me. to shout to our God this morning. Our God is risen. Our God is alive. Our God has made a way for us. He has paid the debt that we could not pay, and he has given us life. So, Lord, as we enter into your presence this morning, we thank you for what today represents. We thank you for the resurrection. And we thank you for the gift of your life.
Thank you.
was borrowed for 3 years. His body there would not remain. Our God has robbed the grave. Come on. Our God has robbed the
thank you. is Stacy, and the Lord calls me a creative connector to freedom. And so I'm going to share some stuff with you guys today, some announcements. The first thing is welcome to everybody who's a guest, and welcome to everybody who we saw last week. I'm glad that everyone's here. You guys are welcome to have a seat if you would like. I'm new to this game. Sorry, you can text the number. That was up there. And then here's the women's group and everything that you can scan the QR code. If you're interested in being part of the women's group, we have crazy talented, wonderful women who all get together and share passion with each other, and we'd love to have even more of you with us. Then there's going to be a worship night on April 10th at 7 p.m., and everyone is welcome. We'd like to have everybody here and celebrate and sing and just worship the Lord and praise God. And then lastly, on the announcements, is tithing, and you can scan the QR code, or there are baskets in the back that you can give to if you feel led to, and we have a really generous church. I know that because I believe that we're out of debt, that we have done amazing things. I know that we get to do amazing things for people. Today, what I want to, just real quick, the Lord really laid on my heart, is just a thing about perspective. The Easter story is not new to us. It's not new to anybody, I don't think. But the Lord just really talked to me about perspective. So if you could bear with me for just 1 second, maybe a little bit longer, like just 1 minute. And I want you to take your pointer finger, and I want you to point it to the sky. And then I want you to draw a circle going clockwise, just like that. And then I want you to bring your finger down, and I want you to look at it. And if you did that right, it's going counterclockwise. Your finger never changed directions. The Lord has never changed. The story isn't different. But let us have a new and fresh perspective on it, so that we are always in awe of how amazing that it is. Lord, thank you. Thank you for what you did. Thank you for who you call us to be. Lord, thank you for everything that you've given to us. Thank you for who you are yesterday, today, and tomorrow, and all that you will continue to do. Lord, and I ask that we are just open and that we have a new and fresh perspective on you through the way we know you in each of our lives. Thank you for everything. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen, amen. Come on. Good morning. If I haven't met you, my name is Leighton. I'm so glad you guys are here. I tell you, this has been my prayer all week, for weeks really, every week it's the same, but especially on Easter, is that you're just come home. You're welcome here. Welcome home. We want you to sit there and relax. My sermon is not going to be any more than 4 hours. I'm joking. It'll be short, but it's going to be powerful. God has given me a word for you guys. And as I was up here yesterday praying, I was praying for Connect Church and I was praying for our church. And man, I just started tearing up as I was walking through, praying over every seat in here numerous times. You are supposed to be here this morning. And God has something for you. I want to tell you a little bit about our church, because there's some of you that are guests and you're like going, what goes on here? We're really about four things here. One, we want you to know God. We've grown up in a city, and we're in a city where a lot of people know about God, but they don't really know God. And we want to be a place, a home, that we can come together and you can know God. And then we want to help you find freedom. And you say, well, what is that about? Man, we all have things that have been spoken on of us. We all have things that we believe about ourselves that just aren't true. And God wants to set us free from that so that, and this is what I'm going to preach about today, we can discover our purpose. You see, each of us in this room have a purpose given by God. And you may be sitting there going, no, no, no way, not me. Yes, you do. And we want, as a church, to help you find your purpose. It's more than a job. A purpose is not just your job. We talk about it kind of as identity. Who did God create us to be so that we can change the world for him? And then that leads us right into making a difference. We want to make a difference in the world. We don't want to be people that just come to church on Sunday and enjoy potluck afterwards and have a worship night once a month. And it's just that we want to go and go, okay, how can we make a difference in the world with every interaction that we have? And if you're like me, then we can come together, and there's times in my walk with Christ that I haven't understood what's going on. That I've had questions, that I've been a little bit angry, if I'm honest with you. There's times in my walk with Christ that I've grown weary. I've grown tired. I've been like, God, you I feel like you call me to this, but I'm not seeing the difference I thought I was going to see. And so we come together in a community, and we'll see the importance of that here in a minute, so that we can spur each other on to run this race that's before us in a manner that is worthy of the King of Kings. And we are here today because he is risen. He is risen. He's not in a tomb. He's not dead. He is risen. I tell you what I'm going to do, and I'm just going to get you on the... I like to share a little bit sometimes about... A lot of people think preachers are these perfect people, and we have these perfect families, and everything just perfectly comes together. It's not true. I've worked on this sermon for I don't know how long, and in the middle of this week, I texted our life group and go, well, guys, I have it down to about 4.5 hours. If you could pray that I get it down to 20 minutes, that would be awesome. But as a pastor, there's so much that you want to share, and you want everything to be just right, because this is my heart. I want you to come in here today and be changed forever. I want you to taste and know and see that God is good. Not just hear about him, but know that. And as we, I have a lot of scripture, but I'm going to go quick, so I'm going to ask you to hang on. Normally, I don't have this much scripture, but to get where we're going today, I want you to see that it's throughout the Word of God, what I'm saying. And I want you to see where we're going today is to see that Jesus knew his identity, and he has an identity for you also. No, we're not God. He was. But we're walking in identity. We have a calling on our lives that is difference making. And so in Isaiah, in the NIV, I don't have my iPad. Hey, John, thank you. John hates being embarrassed, but I tell you, John, I could not run my life on Sunday mornings without John. Thank you, John, so much. Let's give John a hand, even though he doesn't like it. It says this in Isaiah 53. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we were healed. What's this talking about? This is talking about the cross, isn't it? This is talking about when he was beaten, when the crown of thorns that we just sang about were put on him, when all that was going on and he's nailed to the cross. This is what it's talking about. In the Amplified version, it says it a little different. It says this: but he was wounded for our transgressions. He was crushed for our weakness being our sin, our injustice, our wrongdoing. The punishment that was required for our well-being fell on him, and by his stripes, by his wounds, we are healed. What I want to talk to you about this morning is this, is that Jesus came to heal us. And you say, well, I'm not physically sick today. Well, he can heal your body, but that's not just what I'm talking about. Here it's talking about a healing that is spirit, soul, and body. That's how the Bible talks about us, that we are spirit beings, that we have a soul within us, and that we're living in this earthly body. Our spirit is our connection with God. Some of you in this room, if I'm guessing, are not in a good connection place with God. And that's okay. You're welcome here. We're glad you're here. That's why we're here, really. And some of you this week, because I've talked to you and I know this, have said, well, man, I'm really praying about this, and I don't know that I get what's going on. I'm just trying to walk it. I've been there, done that. And some of you, it seems from my point of view, hear God with every breath you take and are just moving in a power that I'm like, well, man, I want some of that. And our soul is a realm of decision. It's your mind, your emotions, your personality. How does that come out? Because we're all different. I have 5 kids. Every one of them is different. I don't know that any of them are super shy. One maybe a little bit more shy than the others. But then I have some that are just jumping out there crazy. You know what I'm saying? Dad, let's get up on stage and dance in front of all these people we don't know. Let's do all this crazy stuff. Their personalities are different when I tuck them in. One of them wants to be tickled and thrown around like a bag of potatoes, and he thinks that's just the best life ever. If I did that to one of my daughters, they would start crying. One of them, and bless God, they have smelly feet sometimes, but one of them likes me to rub their feet. That's their love language for me. They're all different. And every one of us are different, and he created you that way. And what I want you to get across this morning is this, is that you were created by him, for him, in this time, just like you are. And then the last thing is our body. It's just our earth suit. You know what I'm saying? I'm not saying we're aliens, but I'm just saying this is what we're here on earth with. It's how you interact with life. It's what you go through. So he came to heal us, spirit, soul, and body. But sometimes in life, and really this is who I'm talking to this morning, is that we get stuck. Last year, we saw this deal on a house. It was about this time of year. We saw a deal on a house that was really too good to be true. And you know, when you see a house that's too good to be true, it's usually too good to be true. This was the case here. But online, it looked awesome. Had a swimming pool. My kids wanted a swimming pool. Was bigger than our house. Everybody'd have their own bedroom. It was cheaper than anything. It had land. And so we're like, well, let's go find this house. Let me tell you what I did. I put one number in my GPS wrong. It was like Highway 1513, let's say, and I put Highway 1515 or 1514, one number wrong. And we end up on this dirt road in the middle of nowhere, just driving, and it's getting darker, and a storm's coming in, and we just keep going, well, it's got to be right up here. And finally it starts raining, and I turn down the road. Melissa's trying to help me out. We fall into navigation, and we get stuck in the middle of a field. I didn't realize it was the middle of the field in the middle of this rainstorm, but it sure was. We have AAA, we call the tow company. We could see them traveling on the road, and they're like, well, we see your lights, but there's no way to get to you. So we get out of our car and walk to this wrecker in the middle of a storm, rain everywhere, mud up to our knees as we're walking through this field. And all seven of my family and the driver sit in his tow truck with one row on it all the way home. And the next day we come out and get our car towed out of the mud, and we had taken a wrong turn and ended up in the middle of the field, and it's a crazy story. But that's where some of us are, is that we think we're doing the right thing, and all of a sudden we realize, hey, I'm stuck. I'm stuck in the midst of all this. And God gives, we look at Jesus, and we realize, you know, there's not a time that Jesus was stuck. There's not a time that Jesus goes, man, I don't know what to do right now. Phew, 5,000 people, that's a lot of people. No, Jesus didn't say that. He goes, well, what do we got? Let's use it. Let's go. Here we are. And we come and we realize that God was in Jesus, and Jesus is different. God, Jesus is God. Let's look at it, how God handled it. First of all, we see that God gave Jesus a name. She will bear a son, he says to the angel says to Joseph, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he shall save the people, his people, from their sins. He gives them a name that pronounces who he is. It says, hey, you're going to save the world. Your name is Jesus. You're a savior. Then as we go on, we see that even before he's born in his mother's womb, it says that he knew him. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice, she explained, blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of our Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leapt for joy. We see that God names him before he ever comes, that he's known in his mother's womb, And then even as a boy, as a teenager, I don't know if you're a parent in here. I have some teenagers now. There's times that I'm like, well, do you even understand life? Do you understand what I mean when I tell you to do something? But this is where Jesus is as a boy. He goes out. He gets lost. After 3 days, they realize he's missing. Reminded me of a joke that was sent to me this week. It says this: my wife screamed at me saying, "You haven't heard a single word I've been saying to you." I thought, what a weird way to start a conversation. You'll get it here in a minute. But Jesus says this: why were you searching for me, he asked. Didn't you know I had to be in my Father's house? But they did not understand what he was saying to them. He knew who he was. He knew what he was supposed to be doing. He's in his Father's house listening, teaching, and people are in awe is what the Word of God says. He knew his identity. As we go on, he's walking in it. We see that he comes and he does what his Father wants him to do. And we say, well, what is that? And this is what he says in John: for I've come down from heaven not to do my will, but to do the will of the one who sent me. And as you look up, and I'm not big on Greek and all that kind of stuff. Let me just say, I look it up. I took it. I don't remember a lot of it. But this is where we're at. The word will there is themela. And this is what it means. So I want you to think about it in this way: for I've come down from heaven not to do my will or what has been determined for me to do. What God has determined for me to do. He's saying, look, you have an identity. And I have things inside of you that I've determined for you to do. Your will. And he says, it's not about my will. It's what how God made me. And then we go on. And we even see that when it's difficult. Because I think that there's this lax thought in Christianity that, well, if I become a Christian, everything's easy. Everything's great. Christians are always happy. Their children always obey. They always have what they need. And the word says he will supply all our needs according to his riches and glory. But he doesn't say life is just going to always be easy. In fact, he sets the example for us as he's going to the cross. On Friday, he says this: he pulled away from them about a stone's throw. He has three friends that are supposed to be praying with him. He knelt down and prayed, "Father, remove this cup from me. But please, not what I want. What do you want?" I want you to see how difficult it was for him in the next verse. At once, an angel from heaven was at his side, strengthening him. He prayed on all the harder. Sweat wrung from him like drops of blood poured off his face. He's in agony. God, if there's any other way, please. I don't want to do this. I don't want to do this. But it's not about me. God, it's about you. He knew his identity. And I think we see these examples so that we can learn our identity. That's the series we're in. And you're going to have to keep coming to go deeper in this. But today I want you to see this. I want you to talk about this. How do we understand our identity? How do we understand who we are? Because this is what normally happens with people I see, is that they have a false identity of who they are because of what people have said around them. Had a teacher say they're stupid, so all of a sudden they're stupid. Had a parent that said to them, "You're just mean," so they walk around mean. Had somebody in authority say, "You're not going to amount to anything," and that's become who they are. And that's not the identity that he has for you. As I say that, some of you are even realizing this is what's been said over me, and it's false. I want you to hear that. That is a false identity. True identity is this, and this is a quote from Jamie Winship, who's a guy that I've been studying. I went too far. Can you go back one for me? I went too far on that. But Jamie Winship is a guy that I've been studying our identity with, and he says true identity is this. The truest thing deep down within you, grounded and secure in love, to be worked out in community over a lifetime. True identity is received in community from God. Your identity is deep down in there. It's surrounded in love. We know that God is love, and you say, well, I don't even know that I believe in God. Well, he believes in you, and he's created you, and he is wrapping you in his love, and he's built an identity within you that he's helping you to understand, and we have a community that comes together. Why is it important we meet together? One reason is to go, okay, this is who God's called us to be. We have a false voice that's always easy to agree with, isn't it? You're ugly. You look in the mirror and this voice inside of you goes, man, you're just ugly. That's easy to agree with. Man, you're kind of a failure. Look how old you are and what's going on in your life, and look at all these other young bucks around you. Yeah, okay, I'm a failure. Man, I always make D's on my report card. That's just who I am. No, that's a false identity. I want you to hear this. The voice of God always takes faith to believe. It always takes faith to believe the voice of God. It's always more than you would say about yourself. God is always speaking more over you than you would say about yourself. Well, I can't believe that. Well, it's true, because that's who he made you to be. The identity that he knit together in our mother's womb, we see here in Psalms 139. This is about us. For you created my innermost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. Knit there together in my mother's womb does not mean I'm a son. I call my kids Leighton's sons and Leighton's daughters. We know that they're my kids. Knit together here means I have an identity. I've created you for a purpose. It's more of a purpose than going to school. It's more of a purpose than going to your job. It's more of a purpose than being a part of whatever club you are, or playing whatever sport you do, or raising your kids. It's more of a purpose than being a mom or a dad or a son or a daughter. It's more of a purpose than just being a friend. It is a purpose that is within you that pulls out the best in others. You've knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful, I know full well. You've knit me together. And then he gives us a new name. Now, this is an obscure verse that I've read before, but in studying this, all of a sudden, I jumped on it, and I was reminded of it, and I want to come to this. Some of you have never read this before, but this is what Revelation says. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who conquers, I will give some of the hidden manna. He's going to supply your needs. He's going to give you what you need to make it through, is what he's saying there. And I will give him a white stone with a new name written on the stone that no one knows except the one who receives it. You're like going, what is that about? There's a lot of different thoughts on it, but as I studied it, the one that I really feel like registers to me is that when they would race in the Roman, this is written when the Romans were in rule, when they would race, the winner of the race would get a white stone as the mark of they've won the race. They've run the race, they finished the race, they won the race, and their name was on their stone. And as you run your race for Christ, he's looking at you and goes, here, you're going to win this race. You've won the race. You're following me. You're my child, and here's your new name. And that's only for you and I to know, maybe. That's a name that I'm not giving anybody else around here. That's your name. Your parents named you one name, but this is your name. We see it throughout the Word of God, don't we? In the Old Testament, Abram becomes Abraham, father of many nations. Sarai becomes Sarah. Saul in the New Testament, we talked about this last week, becomes Paul. And so we're going to learn. That's why we're here. As we discover our purpose, we start learning, okay, God, why did you create me? You see, right now, he did not create me to work in children's ministry. And you're like going, well, you have five kids. And you were a youth minister. Let me say, first of all, yes, I have five kids. My wife loves me. Praise God. Two, youth ministry is way different than kids ministry. And if I was back there in kids ministry long term, kids would hate it and I would hate it. And I would find a reason not to come to church. But as I start walking in my identity of knowing who I am, all of a sudden there's a fulfillment and I want to. And I'll go, oh man, I want more of this. I want to walk in this more. And we start seeing that. And then we see that as we were knit together, we talked about this already, that we've been saved. I was worried that this was going to go so long that I was going to wear you out. And so I only put down a few verses here, but I'm going to read you the whole thing. As I read this last night, and you're going to go, what do you mean the whole thing? Just a few more verses, okay? Paul, I want you to take into account who Paul was. We talked about it last week, but in case you weren't here, Paul was basically a terrorist. That's what we would call him today. He felt like his duty was this. If you say you're a Christian, it's my duty to kill you for my God. You don't need to live. You don't deserve to live. You're dead. And so God meets him on a road, blinds him, talks to him, and says, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Changes his name to Paul. And this is what we see. He's writing to the church in Ephesus. He's like a father figure to him. This is like a love letter to him. And he says this, once you were dead because your disobedience and your many sins. Maybe that's where you're at today. Maybe you've never given your life to Christ and you're dead. But for those of us that have given our lives to Christ who say, yes, you're my Savior, you're my Lord, we're no longer dead. We once were dead because of our disobedience and our many sins. You used to live in sin, just like the rest of the world, obeying the devil, the commander of the powers of the unseen world. He is a spirit at work in the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. All of us used to live that way, following the passionate desires and inclinations of our sinful nature. By our very nature, we were subject to God's anger, just like everyone else. But God, now listen to this, but God is so rich in mercy, and he loved us so much. He's so rich in mercy, and he loved you so much that even though we were dead because of our sins, he gave us life when he raised Christ from the dead. It's only by God's grace that you've been saved. For he raised us from the dead along with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms because we are united with Christ Jesus. So God can point us in all future ages as examples of incredible wealth of his grace and kindness towards us, as shown in all he has done for us who are united with Christ Jesus. So we've all come together because of what he did on the cross. He showed his mercy. He allowed us to be in relationship with him. And then we come to these two verses. God saved you by his grace when you believed. And you can't take credit for this. It's a gift from God. Hey, it's nothing that you're doing. It's a gift. Salvation is not a reward for good things we have done. So none of us can boast about it. Well, I come to church on Sunday, so I'm a godly man. No. You're only saved through what Christ has done on the cross. And the reason we're here celebrating this day is because he rose again so you could be in right relationship with him. So he gave you an identity and a purpose so that you could fulfill your destiny. For we, now I want you to hear this, you are God's masterpiece. He has created you anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long, long ago. See, Jesus came. I want you to realize this. He came so we could be in the right relationship and do the great things that he planned for us. And some of you are thinking you missed it. Some of you are thinking, well, I'm still stuck in the mud over here. Some of you are thinking, man, I don't know that I agree with you. And that's fine. Let's talk about it. But I want you to hear this in closing today. That God created you. He created you. Before you were ever born, he knew you. And he has a name for you. He has a purpose for you. He has an identity for you. He knew you in your mother's womb. You say, well, I didn't grow up in a good house, but he was there. You say, well, I don't think God was there. I challenge you this week, asking, where were you in the midst of this? Some of you right now may be me going, man, Leighton, you don't know what I did 30 years ago. You don't know what I did 30 days ago. You don't know what I did 30 minutes ago. You're right, I don't. But I know that he created you. He knew you in your mother's womb. He's given you a new name. And he has a purpose for your life. And that purpose, yes, maybe you're a mother or a father, and that's great. That's part of it. But that's not what I'm talking about in identity. Maybe you're a student. Maybe you're a teacher. That's not what I'm talking about either. I'm talking about God. Why? What have you made in me that's different than anybody else? And let's learn together what that is. But I'm going to tell you the first step this morning is we celebrate. And maybe you came in here and you go, well, it's Easter and that's the only reason I'm here. I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you're here. But hear this. He didn't come for just one day for you to come to church. He came for every day. For every day. And some of you, it's time to give your life to him. Some of you, it's time to stop running and rededicate. Some of you, it's time to just worship him in a new way. So right now, as I close, I just want you to do this. If you feel like closing your eyes, I'd like for you to. If you don't, I totally understand. That's fine. But just in your head, quietly where you're at, I want you to say, well, Holy Spirit, what are you saying to me today? Just say, Holy Spirit, what are you saying to me today? Some of you may be thinking right now, well, he's telling me I need to quit this and quit that. No, no, that's not. That's you. What he's going to say is, man, I love this specific thing about you. He's going to say something like, you know, I created you this way. Some of you, he's going to start calling you by your name. Father God, we give today to you. And I ask that we are a people that walk in our identity, that we walk and discover our purpose, that the joy of you fills our hearts, our minds, our souls, and our beings. Father God, some of us are weary. I just pray that we will do what your word says. We will mount up with wings as eagles. We will run and not grow weary. We will walk and not faint. God, we will not grow tired of doing what's right. Some of us in here are searching, and I thank you that we can search and we will find. Your word says that. We can knock and you'll answer the door. We can ask and you'll hear our cries. And so, Father, right now, as your peace is over this place, for those in this room and those watching online, Father, I pray that you're drawing us close to you, that we're committing our lives, our minds, our souls, our being to you, and that you are healing us. Father, for some of us, that is a spiritual healing, and we are lost without you, and we confirm that and just say, I want you to be my Savior. For some of us, it may be a physical healing. For others, it may be emotional healing, financial healing, whatever it may be. We're praying for that right now. And we thank you for the change that you're bringing. In Jesus' name, amen. There'll be some of us up front that would love to pray with you today. I want to say a couple of quick announcements. Guys, if y'all can help, we have lunch ready. There's going to be some people that need to run home and get it. And while they run home and get it, we're going to set up tables and chairs and stuff outside. Also, I see some kids in here, and I understand not wanting to go back in the back. Sometimes it's scary. But let me say, we have a gift for every kid, even if you didn't go to Sunday school, and it's a pretty cool one. It's pretty cool. So you can still have one of those. You can take your mom or your dad back there and get that, and we would love to have you. And you say, well, Leighton, I didn't bring anything for lunch. You don't need to bring anything for lunch. We got it provided. It's going to be fun. We're just going to have fellowship. But this is a big deal. Some of you need some prayer, and you're just like going, man, I just want to pray with somebody. I'm going to be down front. Some other guys are going to be down front, and we would love to pray with you. If you have questions about anything, man, just catch me at lunch. Catch me around here. I'll give you my cell number. You can call me, and we'll talk. I'm all about it. But I want you to hear this. You are loved. God loves you. You were created for such a time as this. There's no one else in the world like you. God says this. This is amazing to me. Every hair on your head is numbered, and he knows it. Every need that you have, I'm not saying every desire, but every need that you have, he can meet. And I bless you in Jesus' name. I proclaim in Jesus' name that you're going to leave here knowing his love and his peace this week. In Jesus' name, amen. You guys have a great week. I'll see you at lunch. We'll enjoy it. Seth will lead us, and the two Seths will help us. There's tables around here, chairs. We'll pull them around, and we'll have a great lunch. Bless you guys.